My name is Ken Hay. I directed the film you're about to see, Southern Voices, American Dreams. This film developed out of a personal interest in the cultural changes that started in the 1960s and worked their way through the 1970s, changes that made possible a curious rise and fall of the South in the American mind. This rise and fall had something to do with the changes in the South itself, but more to do with cultural changes outside the South. The image of the South as an untainted source of non-urban, simple, folksy truth appealed to the nation in its bicentennial era. Many rock music fans shifted their loyalty from acid and urban rock to the outsider traditions of black blues and white country western music that flowed together in southern rock and roll. The crumbling social conventions of the pre-Vietnam and pre-civil rights era received symbolic jolts in the crash and bang of southern road and car films. The Watergate corruptions added to a feeling that the country needed to sweep aside political leadership and start over, a feeling that ironically suited the revolution being celebrated in bicentennial events. National television networks faced a decade of disloyal viewers attracted to the new options opened by cable systems, and one cable giant beamed his signal from the South. All these anti-mainstream or populist movements won the affections of those who had challenged the mainstream in earlier periods. Southern Voices, American Dreams follows these four areas of activity up to 1980, when interest and values changed again. A brief comment about the technique of the film. My partner Virginia Brooks and I decided to omit voiceover narration. The title suggested that the words would come from those who participated in the Southern image renaissance, and any added voice would not only be confusing, but would distance the viewer from the people speaking on screen. Without the voiceover instruction, the viewer, we hoped, would confront the images fresh and interpret them as they came. As filmmakers, we injected our ideas into that flow through our selection of images to be seen and through the sequencing of those images and sound. As a result, the music became the narration. The first section to be seen tonight briefly introduces the various people who will appear as the overall story chronologically unfolds. The film then moves into an extended montage of events in the 1960s and finishes with a look at the origins and growth of Southern rock and roll. And now, part one of the three-part series, Southern Voices, American Dreams.
The South is the only place that you come from and you feel for your entire life that is home, that's where you're from, you are a Southerner.
I like it here, I'm comfortable here, most of my friends are here, my acquaintances and fellow workers, and I have no desire to leave.
There is a feeling for the land.
I even wrote my parents on one occasion and asked them to put a little Georgia clay in an envelope and send it over there to me to kind of give me a little euphoric feeling every now and then.
A respect for a valuing of, some people would say, an excessive evaluation of tradition.
I grew up on the Grand Ole Opry listening to the radio, and Hank Williams was a big hero in our family.
Not to mention the tremendous economic devastation that took 100 years to come out of, and the political alienation, separation for the rest of the from the rest of the nation.
The only problems are the accents, but most people around here, the acting, young actors that I've met here, the local actors, are able to talk like Yankees.
The one thing that stood out in my mind that I liked about the North is you didn't get hassled about your hair, whereas down South, I mean, the redneck regime got you.
When you say redneck, I think that a lot of people put ignorance on that, you know, where they couldn't be any more wrong. I think they misinterpret pride for ignorance.
It's just attitude, that's all.
That's a good word for it. I mean, it's attitude of the South.
An appreciation for family.
My mother came from Southern Baptist background, as a lot of families in the South were, and she sang in church along with her sisters and brothers. Her parents sang in church. She got us involved in church music early on.
It's the only part of the country that has lost a war, that has been a defeated and occupied territory.
And I saw from a distance, really, the beneficial impact of the civil rights movement in the final victory.
First, whether one accepts it or not, the Supreme Court school decision is an accomplished fact, which will remain so until it either is reversed by the court itself or nullified or modified by the Congress or the people. And second, whether one likes it or not, the overwhelming majority of the people of the South will neither accept nor submit the forced implementation of that decision. There is no prospect of any change in that position within the foreseeable future.
Now, we never thought about laws or segregation or differences, except that when I was about 12 or 13 years old, I began to notice that my black playmates would let me go through the gate first.
Just one more morning, I had to wake up with the blues, pull myself out of bed, yeah. Put on my walking shoes, went out on mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania. Let freedom ring from the mountain of Georgia.
I'm glad I'm a segregationist. I'm glad I'm an American. I'm glad I'm a Georgian. I take great pride in the fact that I'm white.
Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over, and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land.
Lyndon Baines Johnson, we remember your Democratic Party when it twice refused to seat Julian Bond in the Georgia State Legislature.
But you now have the opportunity to show the nation, as they've shown in Detroit and Chicago and in Madison Square Garden, that it doesn't make any difference where you are from, it's what you stand for.
Having grown up in the 50s during the segregation, never ever playing against a black football player until we flew to the University of Louisville. And we were told by the coaches that if we hit these black guys real hard, they'll give up.
And I think Otis Redding and his Georgia contemporaries, Little Richard, James Brown, Ray Charles, had a lot to do with the success of the civil rights movement. It was sort of the philosophy that emerged that if you love the music, well, you couldn't hate the people.
At the end of a long campaign, I believe I know our people of this state as well as anyone could. based on this knowledge of Georgia, North and South, rural and urban, liberal and conservative, I say to you quite frankly that the time for racial discrimination is over.
The monument we dedicate today represents a South that is now and always will be a proud part of our history and of our heritage.
Well, music has always been such a vital part of Southern life, dating back to the days of slavery. It was their one opportunity to express their emotions. There was such an intenseness to that music. That is the foundation of what became Southern music. Carried over because of the closeness of community and of people from the black population to the white population.
Gather for a week before the music started in the camp and just make ready for the festival. It was more like a celebration of life.
At its peak, the music scene in Macon was pretty magic. There were so many creative things going on. There was a real family feeling amongst all the musicians and bands. We hung out together, jammed together in the local clubs. We appeared on each other's records, wrote songs together. We did a lot of growing up together there. And it's a time that I know all of us will never forget. You know, there were certain ingredients that made that all happen in that town at that time. If I had to say who I thought was the most important contemporary figure in rock music as far as the launching of what became known as Southern rock music, it would be Dwayne Allman.
It's been quite a while since you've seen.
Finally, we went on the road with a group called the Minutes, and the same circuit I was playing was a group called the Allman Joys. It was made up of Dwayne and Gregg Allman. And about 1967, the Allman Joys broke up, and our group broke up, and so we kind of merged. Went to California for a couple of years and did a couple of albums for Liberty Records, and played mostly on the West Coast. Played the Fillmore and Whiskey A Go-Go. And the group broke up, and Dwayne went to Muscle Shoals to do sessions for Rick Hall fame.
Rick Hall, this friend of mine who was a record producer in Alabama, a very fine one, was in New York on a trip that I happened to also be there. And he was playing me the latest Wilson Pickett session that he just recorded. And he played me this song. It was a cover of the Beatles, Hey Jude. And I asked him, I said, who the hell is that playing guitar? Because he had the normal session player he used played a certain way that was very distinctive. But there was something magic about this guitar player, again, that transcended the tape. And Rick was one of the more colorful record producers in the South, kind of chomped on his tongue, said, it's long-haired old hippie guy. And I said, long-haired old hippie? He said, yeah, got hair down his damn shoulders. I said, but that son of a can play the hell out of guitar.
Well, I had known Dwayne Allman and Gregg for a number of years before the Allman Brothers Band actually formed as such. And Dwayne came to Jacksonville, where Barry Oakley and myself were playing in a group there. And he was just planning on putting a trio together with Johnny Johnson and Barry Oakley and Dwayne. And so in the process of the jam sessions and what have you, Butch Trucks became involved in it, and Dwayne and I were playing some unusual things together, so the band turned into a six-piece group instead of the trio.
And he called me on March 26, 1969, I'll never forget it, and said that he had this band together, but they didn't sing much, and they didn't write very much. And at that time, he gave me probably the finest compliment I've ever had. He said, I need you to come out here and round this thing up and send it somewhere. And so I was there immediately. And so I was actually technically the last one to get in the band.
And needless to say, it was sort of a social phenomenon for Macon when they first arrived. Long hair had not come in, and they had some of them shoulder-length hair or longer. And guys would really turn around in the street when they would see one of the Allman Brothers and their lifestyle. They rode around town on motorcycles, and they became rather well-known, if not for their music, for other reasons in a short time.
Getting there was the best part. You know, I mean, we had no money. We were just, desolate. But every day we'd rehearse anywhere from 3 to 10 hours, and the songs would just come in like that. And I remember that in 1 week, I think I wrote maybe 6 or 7 songs that you might recognize today. I remember one night I wrote Whipping Post. I wrote it on an ironing board cover. It came so fast I didn't even have a chance to get the paper or anything. That's the way the good songs come. They just hit you like a ton of bricks.
Georgia. And so we held fast, and we didn't want to leave our roots and where we felt comfortable.
People I've ever met to date. He was a real driving force in the band because it seemed like when he was playing, it would just pull it out of you. I don't care if you were dog tired, if you were half asleep, something happened. I mean, he always, I got a lot of inspiration playing with him. I mean, it's like he demanded it. Hell of a dude. You had to have known him. Back together, and then there was Oakley, and after that it hit a real low there, but then we just dug back in, and I remember that it seemed like the first gig that we played after my brother passed away, it seemed like that Dickey Betts learned how to play slide guitar on the plane on the way up there.
Dickey pretty much came more into prominence, and his style was came to light a little more. The Allman Brothers Band got a little more country.
Touring in each region, and marketing in each region, airplay in each region. At the height of the Allman Brothers era, they were just as important in Atlanta, Georgia, as they were in Des Moines, Iowa, Los Angeles, San Francisco, New York, Boston, or Philadelphia. Some of the advantages that Capricorn enjoyed over other similar custom labels or small independent labels or personality labels, whatever you might want to refer to them, is one, we were in the region where so much was being created. So we had an identification with them, a close proximity to them, and there was a comfortable feeling between all Southerners.
Besides the advantages gained from quality musicians, Southern rock and roll benefited from a carefully orchestrated plan to push the Southern image on a post-1960s audience. The producers used advanced technology to capture a finely crafted traditional music, and they used a focused marketing strategy to advance a down-home image. The technique of using sophisticated media to reproduce a blatantly traditional message worked in filmmaking and politics as well. Next week, we look more closely at the films of Burt Reynolds and the politics of Jimmy Carter as they furthered the ascent of a popular South on the American mind.